After many generations of watching the night sky, it was clear to the ancient observers that there was an underlying order and structure to the cosmos. In addition to the cycle of night and day and the phases of the moon, when measured against the background of stars, they found that the objects they were watching had a repeatable and predictable motion. And a good example of this is the motion of the moon. If an observation is made when the moon is adjacent to a prominent star, then when it returns to that star, an interval of time can be calculated. This is known as its sidereal period, or in the case of the moon, we simply call it the sidereal month. Now, the ancients were well aware that this was merely an average representation of the time interval. They might not have had our modern understanding of exactly why it was so, but they certainly knew that the moon sped up and then slowed down during its trip back to the same reference point, and that even that small oscillation was itself continuously moving throughout each cycle. It's perhaps the most remarkable aspect of the device that such subtle observations were mechanically represented within its gearing. And it began with the calculation of the mean lunar sidereal month. As a further resonance of the metonic cycle, it so happens that 254 sidereal months also almost exactly equals 19 solar years. So much like the metonic gearing, the sidereal period of the moon can be given a convenient mathematical expression. Now, of course, many aspects of this machine were pushing the engineering limits of the day. But this part of the train in particular takes it closer to the edge than the rest. And it's those engineering limitations that I'd like to go through now. To begin with, the gearing rapidly steps up in this part of the train, demanding relatively fast rotations from assemblies with considerable inertia. And this puts a heavy load on some very small components. For the most part, the high loads are dealt with in the same manner as the rest of the mechanism. Square arbors fitting into square holes, well peened into position. But the teeth are at their greatest risk of damage in this part of the train, and there's no better example of the material limitations experienced in the mechanism. Much like the M assembly, the D assembly must be capable of removal from the main plate. Additionally, the maker elected to run it flush against the underside of the E assembly platform, and in so doing, created the requirement that the D assembly be fastened with a recessed retaining pin. Now you'll have noticed that the wheels and pinions in the mechanism are quite thin, in most cases between 1 and 2 millimetres thick, and they obviously need to stay well meshed to function correctly. In modern clockmaking, the meshing is ensured by setting a limiting end shake with the pivot shoulders, and to some extent by using relatively long pinions that can tolerate a small amount of longitudinal shift between the components. But the sleek design of this machine rules out the option of using longer pinions, and the concept of shouldered pivots had apparently not yet been invented. Generally, the issue was solved by allowing a small clearance on the inside of the arbors, a bit like a simple axle. It provides the required limits to the movement at the cost of a higher friction penalty. A good example is the way that the M assembly was fabricated. But in this higher load section of the train, the maker discovered that method was unsuitable and was forced to come up with a more reliable solution. It shares some of the features of a modern bridge, but it might be more correctly described as a sort of thrust plate that captures the small pinion while still permitting its free rotation. Whatever you choose to call it, it performs almost exactly the same function as the shoulder of a modern pivot, albeit with more friction. Locking the longitudinal travel of the assembly and ensuring a very limited and precise end shake. But as effective as this idea is, it still leaves one part of the problem unsolved. A natural limitation of the larger wheels, due in part to the simple square seating, is the tendency for them to very slightly tilt out of the horizontal plane. For the low load assemblies, this isn't really an issue, but for the high loads in this part of the train, and elsewhere in the mechanism, like the main solar drive wheel, this dramatically affects their efficiency, and at worst, can quickly lead to them becoming damaged. So it was clear that they required stabilisation, and for that, the maker came up with the idea of these small stabilising strips, known as curbs. Carefully set to the correct height, they acted as a guiding surface that limited the extent to which the wheels could twist out of alignment. Now, as it happens, there's an interesting combination of methods used to fasten these curbs to the main plate. Some were fastened, as you've seen here, using pins, but others were soft soldered into position, and that's a process that I figured was worth looking at in more detail. So be sure to check out that video if you haven't already done so. The stud for the C assembly is the final component to be fabricated for this part of the train, with a small notch filed to provide clearance with the D assembly hub, and a pin used to maintain its orientation with the main plate. And I should also mention that there are two final curbs to install underneath the main solar drive wheel that, if installed now, would partly obscure the internal view of the mechanism. So I've decided to hold off fixing those until a later stage of the build. In any event, as unorthodox as the solution appears, the curbs turn out to be quite effective. The friction penalty has certainly increased, but it is quite acceptable. And importantly, the objective has been achieved, because the assemblies are now constrained into their operating planes as required, to the extent that the tiny wheel known as E2, which is now rotating at the mean sidereal period of the moon, is now a reliable input to the next part of the mechanism, the epicyclic pin and slot gearing. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later.